Listening Library presents Gertie Milk and the Keeper of Lost Things by Simon Van Booy. Read for you by Miriam Margolyes. Welcome to your life. There's no turning back. Tears for Fears. Chapter 1. Lost on Skuldark. The girl lying motionless on the sand suddenly opened her eyes. The tide had come in, and she was drowning. Waves rolled over her face, then carried her up the beach, as she gasped with the shock of freezing water. When the girl was able to stand and scramble up some loose stones away from the incoming tide, panic took over, as she realised very quickly that she did not know where she was or even who she was. It was as though the sea had washed away everything about her life, leaving only her body, which trembled with cold, as she stood there in a wet, baggy gown with thin cloth shoes on her feet. The girl looked frantically around and wondered if she should call out, start screaming for help. But there was nobody. She was alone. With the absence of sudden danger, the girl calmed a little. Her breath resumed an even pace, and her heart sank back down in her body, where she could no longer feel each thump like a stone against the wall of her chest. She collapsed on some dry rocks and looked out to sea. The spot on the beach where she had woken up was now underwater. All around there were boulders covered with slick seagrass, like the wet fur of some once terrible creature that had not risen for 1,000 years. Farther out, a white mist unfurled over the dark water, like creeping breath. There seemed to be no escape. The beach was enclosed by tall cliffs that erupted from the shore and stretched as high as she could see. The girl wondered if she had banged her head and fingered her scalp for bumps or the jagged edges of a scab. But she didn't feel like there was anything wrong with her mind. All her thoughts seemed to stick, but behind each question was a darkness from which she could pull nothing. She looked carefully at her sopping ragged gown for any markings or labels sewn into it. That's how she found out her name was probably Gertie Milk. "Strange," she said, rubbing the small letters sewn into the fabric. "I remember milk is something white you can drink, and that Gertie is a girl's name. But as to how old I am, or where I was born, or why I'm here, I could be anybody or nobody." Her missing memories might have been close, just a few thoughts away. But trying to remember felt like going around a corner that never ended. Gertie's throat was so dry from thirst she felt the sides when she swallowed. But she somehow knew that a person can't drink seawater because it's full of salt and the taste of it makes you feel sick. As the rising tide splashed over her feet, Gertie crawled backward over the stones. The entire beach would soon be deep underwater. She needed a path that would take her up the cliffs to safety. It was painful to walk on the loose rocks, but Gertie decided she would rather have bruised feet than drown. When the rolling mist separated over the water, she stopped and stared out to sea for any sign of a ship she might have fallen from. "I know what a ship is," Gertie thought to herself, "and I have language, yet I can't remember any particular ship or even the name of the language I'm speaking." What felt most strange about losing her memory was that she had no idea how she looked. She'd seen her feet and even taken a few glances at her body under the gown, but the sea was moving too quickly for any kind of reflection. It would be some time before Gertie knew the colour of her eyes, the shape of her ears, the angle of her nose, or was able to stare at the curious mark that crept over one side of her face. When the beach came to an end, Gertie clambered onto some dry boulders and looked around for a path that might take her through or over the rocks. The fog was now creeping along the stones as though following her, and the tide was sweeping in faster than ever. With each breaking wave, the water pulled back with such force that Gertie could see small rocks, sand, and shells getting churned into watery fists. Then she spotted something, long and white, wedged in a crack along the rock face. Gertie shuddered at what she felt sure was a human bone, maybe a leg. She closed her eyes and took several deep breaths. She could feel the pressure of tears in her throat and a pushing behind her eyes. But then it occurred to Gertie that she might have ended up on the beach after escaping something even more horrible than bits of a skeleton. But what? She quickly scanned the clifftops for any movement, some hairy, lumbering creature, or a horde of bloodthirsty cannibals. If it were an island of cannibals, Gertie decided she would try and convince them she was a witch, with amazing magical powers, only she had forgotten how to use them. Then Gertie's foot knocked something. Loose stones and a dirty white skull went crashing down to the beach, rolling to rest in an upward position, as though grinning at her. The sound echoed through the cliffs, and Gertie felt dizzy, as though she might tumble down off the rocks herself. Then something moved in the fog. The girl with no memory held her breath as her body turned rigid from fear. It was an enormous white bird with bulging yellow eyes, and it was tearing across the beach stones toward her in great flying strides. Chapter 2. The worst is yet to come. Gertie scrambled down the rocks, but there was no use running, and turning her back upon the beast felt like the worst thing to do. The bird let out a piercing screech and snapped its cruel beak open and shut. Gertie grabbed a handful of stones and stood her ground, shaking with fear, but determined to protect herself. Everything was happening so fast that she couldn't think. If it was time to die, Gertie knew she would go down fighting. When the animal was almost upon her, Gertie raised an arm to protect her eyes from its sharp beak. But the bird stopped suddenly, just a few yards in front of her. She stared as the creature tilted its head back and forth, as though trying to make up its mind about what Gertie could be. "Friend!" she cried, hiding the fistful of stones behind her back. "Not food! Friend!" Then, as Gertie backed away slowly, one of her shoes came off. The creature looked at the shoe, then bent forward and prodded the wet cloth with its beak. Gertie continued creeping backward, still with the small hard stones in her grasp. But then, to her utter dread, she noticed far in the distance a dozen more birds bounding toward her. The stones would be useless against so many. The curious animal in front of her was still playing with the shoe, poking and prodding with its beak. Then, in one motion, it hooked and flung the soggy cloth through the air so that it landed on Gertie's bare foot with a slap. Maybe the bird was trying to help in some way, Gertie thought. Maybe it knew a way off the beach. Perhaps she could even ride on its back as they floated over the waves to safety. Its yellow eyes seemed now full of curiosity and shyness. Gertie dropped the stones and pulled her shoe on quickly. The creature watched, nodding its head. Thick white fur covered its body, and its wings were so tiny, flight seemed more like an idea than a possibility. Gertie knew that her only hope was to make friends with it. And so, cautiously, she reached out her hand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.